Superintendent of Schools for the West Irondequoit Central School District, Mr. Jeff Crane.
Well, good evening, everyone. Welcome to County Executive Maggie Brooks' 11th and final State of the County address here at Irondequoit High School in the West Irondequoit Central School District. As many of you know, Maggie was sworn in January 2004 as the fifth county executive and the first female to lead Monroe County since its formation in 1821. Prior to her election as county executive, and as I served as principal of this wonderful building, Irondequoit High School, Maggie and I worked together in building the partnership between home and school that is vital to student achievement. Maggie's daughter, Julia, graduated from IHS in 2003, and daughter, Jensen, in 2007. But our partnership, based on trust and mutual respect, continued. I might add that this partnership served our constituencies well over the years, because I knew from my earlier work with Maggie that she valued her education at East Irondequoit, the education received by her daughters at West Irondequoit, and most importantly, she values the role public education plays for our future generations. I honor Maggie's efforts to meet the needs of her constituents and her advocacy on their behalf, especially in these times of reduced revenue and ever-increasing costs. The public-private partnership she has created and the accessibility she has provided the 750,000 residents of Monroe County is very impressive. Ladies and gentlemen, it is my distinct honor to introduce our Monroe County Executive, Maggie Brooks.
Good evening. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much. Don't get me going. We're just starting the evening here. Thank you so much. Thank you, really. I appreciate that. Good evening, and welcome to West Irondequoit High School, Irondequoit High School. As we do every year, could you please join me in a moment of silence for all of our hometown heroes in military service to our country? For those patriots we've lost this past year, for all of our dedicated first responders who risk their lives daily for the safety and security of this community, and for the late officer, Daryl Pearson. Thank you. I want to thank Superintendent Crane for that kind introduction, for his gracious hospitality tonight, and for his unwavering support of our children. I have seen this man in action as a principal, as a superintendent, and second to none, believe me, he's amazing. And I want to thank the members of the Irondequoit Chorale for their wonderful performance tonight, led by director Kristen Graham. Brings back a lot of memories for me to hear them sing. And I want to mention our county attorney, Meredith Smith, her daughter, was a member of that group tonight. So what a talented group of young students. So let's thank them. I want to welcome all of you who are watching from home on Time Warner Cable News or listening on WXXI Radio. For those on Twitter, I encourage you to follow my account at Maggie_Brooks or hashtag SOTC2015. We'll be sharing highlights of the address and fun enhancements to the speech that you won't see anywhere else. We have many elected officials and community leaders here tonight. I'd like to take a moment to thank Sheriff Patrick O'Flynn, County Clerk Cheryl D'Onofo, District Attorney Sandra Dorley for their commitment to excellence in county government. To the members of the Monroe County Legislature, thank you for your service and for the important role that you play in the enhancement of county policy. To my critical partners at the town, village, and school district level, thank you for your continued efforts to put taxpayers first. And finally, I will talk more about her later, but welcome and thank you to Mayor Lovely Warren for being here tonight. I am a big believer that good politics leads to good government, and I want to welcome three very important men in my life, Chairman Bill Rylick, Chairman Tom Cook, and Chairman Steve Corin. I want to thank them for being here and for their ongoing support of our efforts. I would like to recognize Monroe County's first executive. Lucian Morin is here tonight. Lucian, would you please stand? Mr. Morin, please stand. Lucian Morin was our very first county executive, prior to that the county manager, and Mr. Morin, you are the gold standard by which all of us will follow, and so we thank you. His vision put this community on a path to prosperity, and it's been an honor to follow in his very large footsteps. There's a reason why I chose this venue for my 11th and final State of the County address. Irondequoit is a town that will always have a special place in my heart and in my life. Being here brings my 20-year political and governmental career full circle. It's a location that stirs many personal memories and represents many family connections as well. I was raised in this town. In the 1950s, my parents bought their first house on Walsford Road. My dad worked for the Times Union, and my mother was a Rochester City School District teacher and then a fourth grade teacher at Whipple Lane in East Irondequoit, where my brother and I attended school. How lucky were we? Our mother a teacher right down the hall. There was a man named Ivan Green who was principal at the time, and now the school bears his name. As county executive, I've had the opportunity to return to that school as a guest reader, and when I tell the students that I actually knew Ivan Green, well, I might as well have said I knew Abraham Lincoln, because they cannot believe it. I just say to them, that means I'm old. My daughters, too, have benefited, as you've already heard, from an upbringing in Irondequoit and an education in the Irondequoit schools. Julia and Jensen graduated from this school, and there are a flood of fond memories that greet me every time I walk through these auditorium doors. School plays, chorale, band performances on this very stage. And I was a very proud Odyssey of the Mind coach for both of my daughters for many, many years, so it makes me proud to see their state and world trophies on display here at the school. But here's some Irondequoit trivia for town residents who live on Wisner Road. Supervisor Adam Bellow, did you know that the road is actually misspelled, the name of the road? Well, it's true. Durand Eastman Park, including the beach, was originally a 150-acre dairy farm owned by a man named Adam Wiesner, my husband's great-grandfather. In 1900, Dr. Henry Durand and a gentleman named George Eastman made an offer that the Wiesners couldn't refuse. They sold the land, which eventually was donated to the city, and we all know what happened after that. The county now operates it at one of its pristine parks. But the Wiesners were allowed to keep their log farmhouse located on what was supposed to be Wiesner Road. They just left out the E. Now that's a true story, and it's documented by town historian Patricia Wayne. My husband is here tonight, Bob, and his son Jim, and Jim's wife Rachel, and we thank you for the park. It's beautiful, and everybody continues to love it today, and I still get scolded for giving away the beach. As you can see, the personal connection runs deep, but never did I imagine growing up that one day I would be a voice for this community and government. Public service for me started in 1977 when WHAM, a powerhouse radio station at the time, gave a young graduate of Ithaca College a job in the newsroom. My broadcasting journey took me to Channel 10 in 1980 and then to the private sector in 1994 at a satellite radio network owned and operated by Tom Galassano. In 1995, residents of the legislative district in Irondequoit literally changed the course of my professional life when they had the faith and confidence to elect me to the county legislature. It has been my great honor to serve this community for 20 years, first as a legislator, then county clerk, and then as the first female and three-term county executive. When I first sought this office in 2003, I promised to protect taxpayers, create a government that would live within its means, support companies that create and retain local jobs, and establish a new spirit of cooperation and with community government partners to enhance our quality of life. I've spent the last 12 years fulfilling those promises to protect the future. We've celebrated amazing success. We've overcome incredible challenges, but we have never lost sight of the end game, leaving this county better than when I took office. Politics and governing are about working as a team, but governing well is about relationships. I truly believe that. There's a spirit of cooperation in Monroe County that has defined much of the success we've seen over the past decade. Leaders who've been willing to leave their politics at the door to put aside self-interest for the greater good. I've had the privilege of working with 5 mayors, and I have enjoyed a strong partnership with each of them. But I must admit, the ability to work well with Mayor Lovely Warren has been unique and productive. It started with a meeting of the minds on Costco, part of the important and transformational CityGate project. Go figure, 2 women bonding over a shopping experience. But the mayor helped secure needed votes to jumpstart the stalled project in the county legislature. That collaboration set the tone for our relationship. We have a shared vision of a community where our world-class quality of life extends to all residents. That is why the Anti-Poverty Initiative is a shared commitment. Rochester has the 2nd highest rate of poverty in the nation for communities of comparable size. And while the concentration is greatest in the city, the rate of poverty is growing in suburban areas. Monroe County is one of the largest social service providers in the region. Thousands of people come through our government's doors each year for help. But despite best practices and best efforts, families continue to struggle. That is why I am proud to have joined Mayor Warren, Assembly Majority Leader Joe Morelli, and the United Way to convene an unprecedented alliance of stakeholders from all over the community to create a strategic plan to fight back. We can do better. We must do better. And with the governor as a partner, we have a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity to make a difference. It's not about additional handouts. It's about giving a hand up to those struggling to find a road to self-sufficiency. It's about aligning resources for greatest impact. Our group will submit recommendations for change to the state this summer, and Rochester will become an incubator for impactful change that can be replicated in other New York cities. But we already have the answers to one problem: finding and keeping a job creates a pathway out of poverty. When I first became county executive, most economic development was led by government. We were trying to market the community, attract new business, retain existing jobs, offer assistance to companies large and small, but we just didn't have the staff or the resources to do all of it well. Sometimes we collaborated with other levels of government, but oftentimes we were in competition. Today, we speak with one voice. By working with Greater Rochester Enterprise, the Rochester Business Alliance, Empire State Development, and the Finger Lakes Regional Economic Development Council, we have focused our collective efforts on projects and priorities that will create jobs and leverage private investment. Each year, through the council, our 9-county region competes for state funding to aid our efforts. And this year, we have a unique opportunity to compete for upstate revitalization dollars. 3 New York regions will receive $500 million, $100 million a year for 5 years, to support projects in industry clusters that will help define our future economy. Our council chairs, Danny Wegman, and U of R's Joel Seligman, are leading this effort. Please join me in thanking them for their hard work. There is no question that Monroe County's economy is changing. In 1980, Kodak, Xerox, and Bausch & Lomb together employed nearly 75,000 local workers. Today, employment at those 3 companies has dwindled to less than 10,000. In 1980, there were 330,000 jobs in Monroe County. Now, despite corporate losses at the big three, we have 376,000 jobs. How can that be? Well, today, the big three look different. It's the University of Rochester, the Rochester Regional Health System, and Wegmans. We are still number three in manufacturing in New York State, but our focus has shifted to include optics, healthcare, education, food and beverage, alternative energy, and agriculture. We have 5,000 small businesses that have fewer than 100 employees. Many were started and are led by entrepreneurs who left Rochester's big companies and used the talent and expertise gained at larger firms to launch their own successful businesses. Each and every day as county executive, I focus on two realities. Number one, government does not create jobs. That's the role of the private sector. And two, companies have choices. They do not need to be in Monroe County and will locate where they have the best chance of success. I constantly visit local companies who tell me that incentives matter. Incentives matter because they level the playing field in our highly taxed and overregulated state. Since 2004, our most important business assistance agency, COMITA, has helped almost 1,500 companies grow and expand. Our tool belt of job programs and services has supported the creation and retention of 110,000 jobs, nearly one-third of all the jobs in Monroe County today. There's a reason our unemployment rate is 5.1%, one of the most stable rates in the state, and well below the national average. But we can't just measure success on job numbers alone. Success must be related to private investment as well. The companies we've worked with have invested $5.3 billion in our local economy since 2004. COMITA, it's been an acronym praised and vilified by area naysayers and in the local media where failure is showcased and success ignored. Every year, the state looks at our numbers as a benchmark for other IDAs. Over the last 12 years, $245 million incentive dollars were provided to area companies with a benefit to our company, our community, of $963 million. That's a 4-to-1 return on investment, one of the best returns in New York State. According to the state controller, COMITA is run efficiently. The average cost to run an IDA per project in New York State is over $18,000. The cost to run COMITA is just under $4,000, a quarter of the cost. COMITA is ranked second in total number of projects and third in jobs created. Companies benefit, but it's the taxpayers who are reaping the real rewards. And Monroe County's IDA has a unique requirement that's ensuring local jobs for local people. In 2004, I fulfilled a promise to add 100% local labor requirements to all projects using COMITA assistance. I'm proud to say that since 2004, we've seen an 8% increase in the use of local labor, and we've had over 19,000 construction jobs filled by local workers since that time. In 2014 alone, more than 1,100 construction jobs were created through the local labor requirement. The success of these programs is the result of the hard work and dedication of the men and women who volunteer their time to work with local companies and act on assistance applications. Tonight, I would like to recognize our COMITA board members, Chair Teresa Mazzullo, Ann Burr, Jay Popley, Gene Kakamas, Clint Campbell, Mary Warbois-Turner, and Mark Seawick. Your collective work is one of the reasons Rochester has been named one of the friendliest cities in the state for small business, the fifth easiest city in the country to start and maintain a business, one of the most unexpected cities for high-tech innovation, and a top region for job growth. But I have failed to mention our true secret weapon in the fight for economic success. I could not have fulfilled the promise of supporting job creators in Monroe County without Planning and Economic Development Director Judy Sile. Judy, would you stand up? I know she's here. Thank you. And stay standing. Stay standing. Judy, who's sitting down, She doesn't pay attention. Judy is an unsung hero in the fight for jobs. Recently, she was named the 2015 Economic Developer of the Year by the New York State Economic Development Council, an honor that she truly deserves, an honor that she has worked very hard for. After 24 years with the county, she'll be retiring June 18th. But ask any company that she's worked with, her tireless efforts will have a lasting impact on our community because of every job created and every dollar invested in our economic future. Judy, what can I say? Our community is better and more vibrant because of your service. Thank you so much. Every year I stand here and talk about the people and the ongoing efforts creating momentum in our county. But let's be honest, it's not just collaborative efforts around economic development, the competitions for state dollars, or government incentives alone that will ensure our vibrant economic future. It is the men and women who own and operate the companies that are taking the risks. They have the ideas, they put up the private dollars, they leverage assets to get bank loans for buildings and equipment. They hire and pay the workers and provide benefits that ensure a better quality of life for families. And depending on the state of economy, they juggle priorities and make decisions to keep the doors open and the lights on. And the products and services they create give Monroe County a broad reach and a high profile. McAlpin Industries, one of Rochester's oldest companies, makes the metal parts for the game Operation. Harris RF manufactures military radios used by our troops all around the world. Ledestri Foods makes all kinds of national products here, like Francesco Rinaldi, Paul Newman, and Barilla pasta sauces. Hammer Packaging makes labels for Snapple, Poland Spring, and Tostitos. True Sense Imaging captures all of the images that you see on Google Maps. And Fee Brothers is a fourth-generation family-owned business in Rochester that manufactures over 100 products such as cocktail mixes, cordial syrups, bitters, and they market those to restaurants, bars, and distributors all over the country. The list could go on and on and on. I won't, but you get the idea. The quality of Monroe County's life depends on the success of those local businesses. And often, that does mean the success of local families. There are many family-owned companies here that understand the importance of passing the torch to the next generation. Precision Grinding and Manufacturing is run by the Hockenbergers. Todd has joined us tonight. He works with his brother Mike, their dad Bill, and their stepbrother Doug Caldwells. They work side by side each day to maintain and sustain what is a thriving local business. The company's been in the city since 1967 and has carved out a unique niche that serves a variety of industries, including medical, military, aviation, automotive, and telecom. PGM has 117 employees, and working with Comita, they will be expanding their operation to add space, to service their growing customer base, and to create 12 new jobs. I thank them for their investment in the local economy as they continue to create jobs, but promote Rochester as the manufacturing hub that it once was and continues to be. Thank you for being here tonight. This will be a big year for one of Rochester's oldest companies. Rochester Midland marks its 127th anniversary. The company's led by Harlan Calkins and his children, Bradley Calkins and Kathy Lindahl. They are co-CEOs, and I want to thank the family for joining us tonight. They are a great, great family, and this is a great company. Rochester Midland is a leader in green practice and manufactures an extensive line of environmentally sound products and chemicals. Ambition, ingenuity, hard work drove the early growth of the company in the late 1800s and continues to be the foundation for the company's success today. In 2011, Comita stepped in to help Rochester Midland move to a new production facility, a significant move because the company's other option was out of state. Not only would we have lost good-paying manufacturing jobs, but we would have missed out on a $13 million private investment. thank you to the Calkins family for believing that when it comes to doing business, there is no place like home. Thank you. Since 2004, I've toured thousands of vibrant companies that reflect the great historical spirit of innovation and entrepreneurship we see in Rochester. The optimism and can-do attitude of the many men and women running local companies is contagious. They are our advocates, our ambassadors, and they will ensure that Monroe County remains a premier destination for business in the future. Fulfilling the promise of supporting companies will protect the future, but we also need to understand unanswered challenges. Rebuilding our center city is a challenge and an opportunity that the mayor and I share. 38% of our 2014 IDA benefits were applied to projects in the city, and the benefits leveraged $62 million in private investment. If you've spent any time at all in downtown Rochester lately, you know there's positive momentum. This past year, we lost two incredible ambassadors for our center city. You simply cannot talk about Rochester without talking about Larry Glazer and Joe Floriano. No one believed in the potential of a revitalized downtown more than Larry Glazer. His impact is far-reaching. His vision for the future is now living on through the hard work of his sons, Ken and Rick, and everyone at Buckingham Properties. Larry Glazer said, "My vision starts with the idea that downtown can come back, and it will be vibrant. It will be different than it was." Midtown Plaza, which for a long time was the poster child for revitalization failure in Rochester, is being transformed into Midtown Rising and will stand as a testament to the forward-thinking, failure is impossible attitude of Larry Glazer, one of our community's greatest cheerleaders. $54 million in private investment was the seed money for the project that will help support more than 200 construction jobs, retain and create 345 permanent jobs, and generate over $10 million in benefit to the community. Down the street, our convention center bears a new name, a tribute to Joe Floriano, who was once known as one of our city's most gracious hosts for residents and visitors alike. The convention center has always been known as the house that Joe built, and he did build its success. Its success as one of Rochester's most popular event spaces is a reflection of his passion and commitment to a city that he loved. He was a man with a big smile and a big heart, and we will miss him. Every time the county supports a downtown project, we are supporting the risk takers and leaders who are not willing to accept the status quo. Each project is another piece in the puzzle that will reveal the reinvention of Rochester as a destination. Bob Bartovich is one of those risk takers and leaders. While many people are talking about downtown redevelopment, he was quietly building an amazing high-impact marketing company on Main Street in the Granite Building. CGI started in 1987 with a handful of employees and customers. Today, CGI has a client base of 80,000. CGI received a Rochester Top 100 award for six straight years and is now one of upstate New York's top growing companies. As the owner of the building next door to the county has been watching the progress of CGI for many years. Well, tonight, I am excited to announce that we are finalizing a deal with CGI to purchase the long vacant Gateway and Atrium buildings on Main Street. Yay. That's good news. Max Farish. They say never do your own applause lines, but I couldn't help myself. Max Farish originally sold those buildings to Monroe County for $1, and that was a long time ago. Now CGI will fill those vacant spaces with the young professionals that it's known for hiring. Bob Bartovich is here tonight, and I'd like him to stand, if he would, so we can give him a round of applause. We enjoyed being your neighbor. Bob, thank you. Bob, we enjoyed being your neighbor, but I like being the realtor better. So thank you and congratulations, and we look forward to the partnership. And I think Mayor Duffy is here tonight as well, and he can tell you that this gentleman has been a cheerleader for downtown, and it's a passion for him. And so we thank you for that, because we need people just like you, Bob. Thank you. 12 years ago, my very first project proposed as county executive embraced a vision of combining arts, education, and transit as a way to breathe new life into that old, nearly abandoned city block. In October of last year, after more than a decade of planning, the ribbon was cut on the new RTS Transit Center, completing the vision of a sheltered, centralized space for public transportation users and removing the logjam of buses on Main Street. Talk of a new state-of-the-art downtown home for Monroe Community College students didn't start with my vision, but it quickly became my promise and priority. If you're traveling on State Street, you will notice some new activity at the old Kodak site. Kodak corporate offices are still there, but by September of 2017, MCC will open the door on a space that will enhance the student and faculty experience as well as student learning. For over 50 years, MCC has played a critical role in providing affordable, high-quality education and creating countless opportunities for residents of all ages to pursue their goals and their dreams. MCC has a national reputation for excellence and is an integral part of our ability to develop the workforce of the future. Last year, thanks to the approval of the county legislature, we were able to secure the second and final phase of funding needed to complete this project. In addition, all state and matching funding has been secured. The renderings are exciting, and I can't help but believe that George Eastman would enthusiastically support an educational repurpose to an iconic building that once defined Rochester. I'd like to thank MCC President Dr. Ann Kress, Bob Healy of Labella Associates, as well as John DeMarco and John DeMarco II of DeMarco Constructors for their commitment to an on-time, on-budget home for students. I'd also like to welcome Dr. Joel Frater, the new executive dean of MCC's Damon City campus, who has joined us tonight. Extremely qualified and experienced, he will lead the establishment and then the operation of the new downtown campus and help make the transition to the new building as seamless as possible. This is a big project, and it represents a significant investment on the part of the county, which is the local financial sponsor of the college. But thanks to the support and partnership of some other friends of ours, the Rochester Building and Construction Trades, we will be reducing costs and creating jobs at the same time. In February, the county legislature approved the execution of a project labor agreement, which means maximizing local jobs during the development of the MCC campus. Utilizing the PLA will save taxpayers more than $640,000. I want to thank Dave Young, president of the Rochester Building and Construction Trades Council, for being a great partner and a strong advocate for local jobs. Thank you, Dave. Right next door to the MCC campus site is a county facility that fuels our reputation as Baseball City USA, and it's a major reason we were named the number two sports market in the nation. No question, we love our sports and our hometown teams. And every year, more than 500,000 people visit our baseball stadium, extending the impact of Frontier Field from the city to all corners of the county and beyond. It is hard to believe that that stadium is almost 19 years old. But since day one, the county's been committed to providing our hometown baseball team and loyal fans a world-class experience. We have an incredible partnership with the Rochester Red Wings, and while the county owns and maintains the stadium, the scoreboard and many other improvements you see represent a major investment by the team. But baseball fans know that the way people watch baseball games is changing. It's all about the game, certainly, but it's also all about the overall experience, the food, the recreational opportunities for families, unique viewing areas that promote a more social atmosphere. Frontier Field needs to change with the times. That's why we are supporting a major renovation that will cost $7.5 million on top of the $2.4 million Monroe County's already included in our capital budget to replace aging utilities and infrastructure. And thanks to the Finger Lakes Council, we've secured $1.5 million in state funding for the project. The money will be used to add a new concourse behind the outfield wall that will be home to new seating, amenities, and a kids' play area. We will also renovate the old firehouse and redesign the left field plaza, among other improvements. Naomi Silver is here tonight, and I want to thank Naomi and the Silver family for their continued commitment to Rochester. Thanks also to Dan Mason, Board Chair Gary Larder for their partnership. I'd like them to stand so we can thank them for being a part of our great community. Thank you. And thank you, Desiree, for being here as well. Frontier Field is an important asset. We have a responsibility to take care of it, and we will. The Seneca Park Zoo is a unique Monroe County asset and a top family-friendly attraction. Much has changed since the county started operating the zoo in 1961. There's less bricks and mortar and more natural habitats, which allow visitors a more authentic viewing opportunity. Over the next 10 years, you're going to be seeing some changes now being finalized in a new zoo master plan, changes that you will notice as soon as you walk through the gate. The last remaining original zoo building will be coming down. The county has made a funding commitment to the project in our CIP program as a requirement of our accreditation, and the changes will transform the visitor experience. This year, by the way, we have two big additions to our zoo family. Moki and Shauna are two African elephants that came to us from the Jacksonville Zoo in Florida. Their arrival completes a vision we had in 2004 for an exhibit that would house four elephants. No secret that Lilac and Jenny C have been fan favorites for years, and with our growing herd, we are looking forward to a strong visitor season. Animals don't come to us by accident. The Association of Zoos and Aquariums partners with us to make the decisions. The AZA cited three key reasons why we were chosen, including our first-rate elephant exhibit, our excellent elephant conservation programs, and extraordinary care on the part of our staff. I want to thank our Parks Director, Larry Staub, Zoo Director, Larry Sorrell, our amazing and talented zookeepers, and Pamela Sanchez and our partners at the Seneca Zoo Society for this big win. I have spent my career working to make county government smaller and more efficient, cutting spending and the county's tax rate, but I'm very proud to say that the one thing that's doubled during my time as county executive is the size of our elephant herd. I love it. Funding, fixing, and expanding public infrastructure is important. But it's not always the exciting, high-profile activity that grabs headlines like new elephants do. But our quality of life depends on maintaining roads, bridges, public entertainment, and sports facilities. Far too often, the only time public infrastructure is noticed is when it fails. We saw two examples last year when two state bridges in the area were found to have significant deterioration and were closed. 19 bridges in our nine-county region were built before the Model T in 1908. One out of every five bridges is at least 65 years old and would qualify for Medicare. And New York State has designated 32% of the bridges in this region as deficient. Roads and bridges represent our most critical transportation assets. But without additional state and federal funding for maintenance and repair, those assets will quickly become liabilities. It's a safety issue, and the need for action has never been greater. While the Regional Economic Development Council process has made progress advancing transformational projects, governments no longer have direct access to funds historically made available for public infrastructure. The money's been swept into competition with everything from housing to tourism to higher education. Left without access to those historic funding streams, local governments will be forced to raise taxes to pay for basic maintenance and repairs, and that runs counter to the council mission of strengthening the regional economy. I've asked our council to do what others around the state have already done, create a public infrastructure work group to identify and review potential public projects that, while not categorized as transformational, are equally important to quality of life. Quality of life is one of the three things mentioned all the time when I ask business owners, why are you in Monroe County? But the number one reason they give me is access to a highly skilled workforce. By the end of this year, one in every five American workers will be over 65 years of age. And by 2020, one in four will be over 55 years of age, according to the U.S. Bureau of Labor Statistics. Those are eye-opening numbers that mirror the trends in our local community and underscore the need to double down on workforce development and job training efforts. It is vital that we connect young, skilled job hunters with opportunities. Well, who are those young, skilled workers? More often than not, they are millennials. Born between 1980 and 1994, millennials represent the fastest growing demographic in this country. The Reason Foundation said, understanding what millennials care about, what they believe in, and how they think is a first priority of anyone interested in the future of American culture and ideas, and any employer who understands the value of investing in a future workforce. My husband and I are millennial parents, and like a lot of you watching and listening, only one of our four children has chosen to stay in Monroe County. What can we do to get them to come home? What can we do to get young people who are here to stay? Last fall, we started an initiative to create a millennial culture here in Monroe County. The goal was to identify ways to unleash the potential of this increasingly influential age group. They are called the Monroe 200, and they were nominated by area colleges and young professional organizations. I gave them a very simple charge. Imagine someone giving you a blank sheet of paper and asking you to make a list of everything you would want or need in the community where you choose to live, work, and eventually raise your family. I was blown away by their engagement and enthusiasm. Well, you can see for yourselves.
I'm Trent Monroe, 2007 graduate of School of the Arts. I like the diversity that Rochester has. You know, growing up here, I've had the opportunity and been blessed to, you know, be a part of a lot of different organizations, you know, such as the In Control program.
My name is Catherine Klimek. I am an event planner at the University of Rochester. I help plan commencement as well as other academic conferences. I feel like it's not as overwhelming as some other cities. It's also not as expensive as some other cities. I like that I can get to work in 7 minutes and I don't hit any traffic.
Like, why can't Rochester be a premier spot for entertainment, for science, for sports, for music, everything? It's just like, oh, it's just this little city when there's so much going on here. You have to remember, Kodak, Xerox, Bausch & Lomb, these are worldwide trade companies. You know what I mean? When you watch TV and they say, that's a Kodak moment, that's a Rochester moment.
My name is Joe Cicero. I'm an inquiry specialist in a local school district.
We're really lucky. There's a lot of stuff to do. We go to the canal, we come to the zoo, we go to the Strong Museum.
I am making a difference here. I'm a millennial.
I'm Amy Dorman. I'm 24 years old. I'm an accountant at Genesee & Wyoming Railroad Services. I think what's most important is job security and really finding a place where you're comfortable and see yourself moving forward and advancing. There's an organization available for any interest you really have. I know a lot of my friends volunteer at animal shelters. There's various organizations that help the youth in the area. I know a big one is Food Link. I love just walking down Park Ave. There's so many restaurants, so many different shops, so many different museums. You can really do it all in one place. We as millennials are not going to be tied down by any corporate culture. We do things our own way,
and have the proper resources and knowledge to really make the community a better place together.
Believe me, they are a very impressive group of young people, and people say they're coming. No, they're here. They're here, and they're ready to roll up their sleeves and help us. So we used local subject matter experts, and we facilitated focus groups with the Monroe 200 to give us feedback on issues like education, environment and sustainability, health and wellness, housing, jobs and economic development, recreation and culture, safety and security, and transportation and mobility. Tonight, I am honored to present some of the highlights of the Monroe 200 report. The Monroe 200 has been working for months on this report, which will be a community guide to better attract and retain young talent in our region. Rochester millennials, or as we like to call them, rock millennials, are connected to our community. 88.4% consider the greater Rochester area home, and they report a sense of pride in being here. One participant, for example, reported that he wanted to teach in a place that felt like home, with family and a sense of history. Rock millennials are invested in their community. Most reported wanting to stay in the area and become even more a part of it. More than one of the participants said, "We want to remain here." Rock millennials value convenience. One common theme from all the work groups was the convenience of living in Monroe County. They like the easy commute and access to everything from the airport to Lake Ontario. Rock millennials think we are not too big, yet not too small. They can get around easily, but our community is large enough so they have access to the opportunities that keep them staying local. Rock millennials appreciate a healthy community, an active nightlife, and opportunities for activity. When it comes to arts, recreation, and outdoor activities, they cannot get enough. And while it's not surprising that the millennial generation values recreation opportunities, the value placed on these activities is significant. Rochester and Monroe County would not be able to attract and retain millennials if it wasn't for our local museums, theaters, parks, lakes, walkable communities, summer activities, festivals, and so much more. Rock millennials want access to education. The Monroe 200 believe higher education institutions and the top-notch K-12 education available in suburban schools is a strength. Many millennials want options to further their own higher education. However, they did say they would choose suburban living over city living when they have children because of the reputation of city schools. That's something we're all committed to working on. Rock millennials appreciate the cost of living and housing. They say affordable housing is important to them, but high taxes in the area create that incentive for them to leave. Rock millennials say they want to stay in Monroe County and be part of its future development. They like the opportunity to be part of solutions through the Monroe 200 process. But for them, it's all about jobs. They want access to good paying job opportunities, but not just a job that pays the bills. They're looking for a workplace that uses, grows, and rewards their talent with advancement and allows them to work with others in their own age group. Those are a few of the report highlights, and the upside is that Monroe County has a solid base to build on. We have accessibility, affordability, and an abundance of activities. A lot of work went into the report, and tonight I want you to meet some of the authors. Many of the Monroe 200 are here with us. I'd like them to stand so we can collectively thank them for their thoughtful insights. Could you stand so we can say thank you? There they are. This is how committed they were to this. They were coming in on their own time on Friday nights to work on this report, so we thank them. Many of our subject matter experts are also here tonight, so I'd like to take a moment to recognize them for being great mentors and for their passion for the future of Monroe County. Thank you to MCC President Dr. Ann Kress, Mark Peterson of Greater Rochester Enterprise, Rich Perrin of the GTC, Director of Public Safety David Moore, Don Jeffries of Visit Rochester, Susan Maney from the Parks Advisory Council, Mark Seawick of Mark Seawick Realty, and Laura Fasano from the YMCA. I'd also like to thank our other partners in this effort, Michelle Ashby, CEO of Tipping Point Communications, and our data specialist, Tim Franz, and his team. I'm grateful for their willingness to give local young people a chance to step up, speak up, and take control of this community's future in a way that really will make a difference. At the beginning of the process, I made a promise to the Monroe 200. I told them that this report would not sit on a shelf. Well, over the next few months, I am going to be taking their thoughts and ideas with them to many groups and organizations that need to hear their message. This report will be put into the hands of my government and business partners and key community stakeholders. Each of these young people has a unique story to tell from this experience, so I will be inviting members of the Monroe 200 to join me in presenting meetings and their ideas to the folks in this community. Monroe 200, your words and ideas will help shape the future of this county. You should be all very, very proud. 12 years fulfilling the promise, working collaboratively with other government partners to enhance quality of life, and supporting companies that create and retain jobs. None of it matters, and we cannot protect the future if we don't honor our commitment to taxpayers by creating a government that lives within its means. In 2004, I made a bold but simple commitment to hold the line on property taxes. And every year at budget time, I hear the chorus of opposition voices saying it cannot be done. But every year at budget time, we prove them wrong. We've heard repeated dire predictions from desperate politicians. The fiscal sky is falling, the county's bankrupt, the county's planning massive post-election day tax increases. Well, here we are 12 years later, and I'm proud to say that I will have served my entire tenure without raising the county tax rate. In fact, it's lower than when I took office. In 2004, we had no money in the savings account, and we were searching for annual one-shots to balance the budget. 2015, no one-shots, and we ended 2014 with a $9 million surplus. That's right, a surplus. After more than a decade, our fiscal restraint is paying off. All totaled, we have more than $20 million in reserves. I am grateful to the efforts of Chief Financial Officer Bob Franklin and his team, and each of our department heads here tonight. In light of this news, Wall Street credit rating agency Moody's has improved our financial outlook to stable, which is also great news for local taxpayers. The greatest challenge facing county finances continues to be the crushing weight of unfunded mandates, which account for 85% of our billion-dollar budget. Some say that mandates are like the weather. Everybody complains about them, but nobody does anything about it. Well, that's not the case in Monroe County. I have spent much of my tenure educating the public about destructive impacts of mandates, but we've also been doing something about their impact on the budget. You see, when 85% of the budget is not under your control, you have to work even harder on the portion that is. The biggest factor we can control in our budget is the cost of the county workforce, specifically payroll and benefits. In partnership with our unions, we've kept the growth in payroll to 1% a year since 2004. In fact, gross payroll, which is salaries and overtime, is actually lower today than it was in 2009. We've reduced payroll by 5%, a savings of more than $11 million. By comparison, if we'd given our employees the same wage settlements as other public sector agencies, our payroll would be $60 million more than it is today. Let me put that in context. If we had to balance our budget with a $60 million hole, property taxes would have to be raised 16%, or we would have to lay off more than 1,000 employees, or drastically slash vital public safety and quality of life services. Here's a better example. To make up a $60 million hole, you'd have to shut down the Veterans Service Agency, the 911 Center, the Crime Lab, close all of the county parks, and shut down the DA's office, sorry, Sandra, as well as suspend all county road and bridge work. We would never allow that to happen. But what that does is emphasize the importance of controlling costs any way that we can. We continue to make tough, fiscally conservative management decisions each and every day. We scrutinize every vacancy and only fill the most critical. We analyze our operations and reduce staff accordingly. Since 2004, we have 500 fewer positions, a 10% reduction. We've been just as diligent in our management of benefit costs. We focused on controlling healthcare costs. We're self-insured. Our health insurance cost is $80 million less than it would have been otherwise. We launched an award-winning wellness program to promote employee health and retained a clinical integration firm to identify gaps in care. None of this work has been easy, but it's part and parcel of our commitment to the taxpayers of this community. I have many valuable partners in this fight for fiscal stability. During my tenure, Sheriff Patrick O'Flynn has been a leader in best practices recognized around the state that save money. Through the efficient management of the county clerk's office, Cheryl DeNolfo's returned over $30 million in revenue to the county since 2004. District Attorney Sandra Dorley has been a great steward of tax dollars by running a lean operation and finding continuous ways to do more with less. I'm grateful for their efforts. And I owe a huge debt of gratitude to the members of the county legislature, especially the Republican caucus, for supporting my annual budgets and standing with me each and every year to protect local taxpayers. Because of term limits, some of the faces will change at the end of the year, including mine. I want to ask four legislators to stand: Mary Valerio, President Jeff Adair, Dan Quattro, and Robert Colby. These four are the only members of the legislature who have served with me during my entire 12 years as county executive, and they live to tell about it. So thank you. You have been invaluable partners, and I want to thank you for your service to this community and to your constituents as well. Thank you again. Throughout my career, I fulfilled the promise of fiscal responsibility, protected the future with stable taxes, delivered budgets compliant with the state 2% property tax cap, which controls the growth of the levy, and the Local Taxpayer Protection Act, which controls the growth in spending. This year, local governments faced a new challenge from Albany, and for most of this past year, members of the Council of Governments have been working with the county to respond to the requirements of the governor's property tax rebate program. In order for homeowners to qualify for a rebate, each jurisdiction, counties, towns, villages, have to comply with a 2% property tax cap. Check, we've done that. Then we have to submit a local government efficiency plan to the state budget office. Using the 2014 tax levy as a measure, our plan has to demonstrate a 1% savings for the years 2017, 18, and 19. Based on that calculation, our community's annual savings goal is just about $5.5 million. Well, in Monroe County, our commitment to reduce the burden on taxpayers didn't start with the creation of this plan. Working together to cut costs and share services to increase efficiencies is not a new idea here. It's something this community has been working on for decades. Those efforts are paying off because instead of submitting a plan that meets the state goal of $5.5 million, our plan, submitted on June 1st, represents $60 million in annual savings for taxpayers. County efficiencies in the plan include new and improved pictometry software that will be used by all town assessors and all police and fire departments, a county move to self-insurance, which will save $6 million a year, long-standing shared service agreements like the centralized library system, our consolidated 911 center, our state-of-the-art crime lab, and our under-one-roof public safety training facility and emergency operations center. And just this past year, the county became part of a unique interagency partnership that is a great example of a shared service well done, a cost-cutting project that's a model for dispensing alternative fuels in the region. It's called the Multi-Agency Green Fleet Fueling Facilities Project. and it provides convenient alternative fueling stations at three locations around Rochester. The City of Rochester, thank you, Mayor Warren, and Monroe County now have better access to lower cost fuels for the large fleets of vehicles that we run on a daily basis. It's a shared service that saves money, but also promotes sustainability in our community. One of the short-sighted aspects of the governor's plan, and I do like the governor's plan, is the fact that communities cannot get credit for any efficiency created or implemented before 2012. Well, we included the list anyway, because those many local examples shine a light on just how much cooperation was taking place before anyone in Albany told us we had to. Pre-2012 efficiencies account for another $35 million in savings each year, but they represent only a fraction of the thousands of agreements that exist between all levels of government in Monroe County. Compiling this plan has been tedious, yes, but it's been a valuable exercise in self-assessment and a worthwhile review of the way we've operated for many years. As local leaders, we need to continue to communicate with our residents regarding savings that we've accomplished and the difficult decisions we make on a daily basis to protect them in the face of crushing state mandates. When the property tax cap was first passed, leaders from both parties promised significant mandate relief for municipalities. At that time, mandates consumed 81% of our billion-dollar county budget. Now, 85%. Mandate reform equals real, sustainable property tax reform. We need to stop talking about caps and freezes and start talking about cuts. As government leaders, we have a responsibility to take advantage of every opportunity to reduce costs for taxpayers. But one thing I've come to realize during my 12 years as county executive is that government can't do it alone. Counties are nothing if not creative and innovative when it comes to being more efficient and effective. And while we can't always operate government like a business, we can learn a lot from the private sector on doing more with less. As governments all across this country and county continue to struggle to identify new resources to support critical services, public-private partnerships are being formed to assist governments with service delivery. These partnerships allow governments to provide some services by harnessing the innovation of the private sector without additional bureaucracy or cost. Public-private partnerships save money for taxpayers. It's a proven fact. Some great examples are located in our Department of Environmental Services. When I ran for this office in 2003, one goal was to make Monroe County a leader in the area of recycling and sustainability. 12 years later, I'm proud to say we have had great success, and in many respects, we have been national leaders. This past year, we implemented a new, innovative, and streamlined way for residents to recycle. Single-stream recycling has evolved from a public-private partnership with waste management, and I'd like to thank Senior District Manager Jeff Richardson, who is here with us tonight. Single-stream means no more sorting recyclables at the curb. It's easier for residents, and it's easier for collectors. Recycling information cards are currently being mailed out to all residents in Monroe County Water Authority bills, and the City of Rochester has begun a single-stream toter pilot program to take full advantage of the center's flexible capabilities. We also continue to promote new hours at our one-of-the-kind Eco Park, where you can drop off virtually all things that are hard to dispose of. We're proud of our progress, and to chart a course for a greener future, the county's prepared a new solid waste management plan. For the next 10 years, the plan will establish goals and objectives to reduce waste generation, increase waste recovery, and decrease waste disposal. Because we own a recycling center, a municipal waste transfer station, and a landfill, and wastewater treatment facilities, Monroe County's in a unique position to identify future community needs and protect taxpayer investments. Our plan will include enhanced public education, solid waste and recycling law revisions, and the establishment of a yard waste and organic material coalition to help provide additional options for residents and businesses, helping keep unnecessary materials out of landfills. Alternative disposal methods are always being explored, but an important part of a plan is to secure the benefits of having a landfill. The Mill Seat landfill ensures stable disposal costs. We want to protect that benefit for the next 30 years. The landfill's final cell has been constructed and is in use, and the process has begun to expand the footprint. That will mean continued disposal capacity for county and city residents over the next 3 decades. DES is also building a second power plant at the site to convert captured methane gas from waste decomposition to renewable green energy, or as we like to say, waste to watts. Working with Waste Management, our private partner, to extend the short-term life of this public investment ensures that locally controlled, environmentally sound, and reliable disposal activity will be provided without interruption to this community's residents, governments, and businesses for decades to come. Another partnership I'm very, very proud of is from 2010, when the Sands family stepped up and helped support efforts to build a first-of-its-kind, under-one-roof center for foster care children and their families. We knew that if we could combine those services with a supervised visitation center and co-locate with our Starlight Pediatrics Clinic, we could reduce the length of stay for children in foster care and help local families improve outcomes and help children return to their families or find permanent homes through adoption. Well, it's worked. And since 2008, we've reduced the number of children in foster care by 50%. None of this would have been possible without the compassion and generosity of Richard Sands, the chairman of Constellation Brands. The Sands family Constellation Brands building represents innovation at its best. And I want to publicly thank Richard and Rob Sands and their family for being true champions for our children. Partnerships like programs like Encompass, Nurse Family Partnership, Hillside Work Scholarship Connection, Building Healthy Children, represent Monroe County's strong commitment to reducing costs while improving outcomes for children and families in our community. We have an amazing team in our Department of Human Services, led by our Commissioner, Kelly Reed. Kelly, your leadership will pay dividends for our residents for years to come, and I thank you for that. Let's give her a round of applause. Later this year, I'm proud to say that I will become the president of the New York State Association of Counties. It will be an honor and a privilege to lead an organization dedicated to raising public awareness and understanding about the roles and responsibilities of this unique level of government. I've been in county government for 20 years, and I know that counties matter. County governments were originally created to deliver social service programs for the state of New York. Our mission has evolved to provide hundreds of services ranging from public health to public safety services essential to the creation of healthy, vibrant, and safe communities. But in addition to our expansive services menu, counties protect the health and welfare of residents through resolutions, ordinances, and local laws. During my time as county executive, there are 3 laws that I am especially proud of. In 2005, we passed a pesticide notification law to protect the health of our residents. In 2011, we honored our veterans and passed a law making it a crime to stage a protest within 1 mile of a military funeral. And in 2012, we took a strong stand to protect the safety of our children when we passed a cyberbullying law. Counties matter, and oftentimes lead the fight against increasingly dangerous and daunting societal challenges. Did you know approximately 1 in every 4 women will fall victim to domestic violence at some point in their lives? It's a number that is both unacceptable and intolerable, and it's hard to think about. Domestic violence is an epidemic, a community challenge, and we will be judged as a community on how well we as a community respond. Monroe County has been proud to work with community partners in many ways to address domestic violence where we can make the biggest difference on the local level. Led by our Office of Mental Health and Director Dave Putney, the Intimate Partner Violence Project was formed to look at how we can provide effective and evidence-based treatment to offenders within substance abuse treatment settings. RIT is a key part of the project, which will ultimately assist coordination efforts of key stakeholders from the courts judiciary, probation, the public defender's office, treatment providers, community coalitions, and advocacy groups. Forming a united front, we have a much better chance of achieving our goal of preventing domestic violence. Heroin is an epidemic that is plaguing our community, destroying our families, and inciting violence in our streets. Heroin is a true modern-day danger threatening our quality of life. Heroin is not just an urban problem. It's finding its way into schools and homes in every part of Monroe County's, and the numbers are staggering. From 2011 to 2014, the number of heroin cases submitted to the Monroe County Crime Lab has increased by over 300%. The amount of heroin tested by our lab has increased 700%. It's a sad and growing reality that hardly a week goes by without news that heroin has taken a life with promise, a life with potential, a life that shouldn't have been lost to drugs. Our community is not unique in facing this challenge, but by being proactive, we are unique in making a difference. Our nationally accredited regional crime lab is led by Administrator John Clark and our drug chemistry supervisor, Jim Wesley. The lab is one of our most important crime-fighting assets, and it works closely with law enforcement and prosecutors to process and analyze suspected illegal drugs and produce results that can be used in the prosecution of suspected crimes. The lab also works closely with medical examiner Dr. Carolyn Dignan and her staff to examine deaths of known heroin users. Drugs from a scene can be sent directly to the crime lab for analysis to determine if something other than heroin may have been a cause of death. In one case, the crime lab tested heroin seized during an arrest in the Southern Tier. The analysis showed that a known horse tranquilizer was mixed in with the heroin. The lead agency was notified along with law enforcement partners in the surrounding area. When Erie County, to the west of us, heard the news, they re-examined four recent heroin overdose cases and discovered the same mixture caused death there. Good local work that led to far-reaching results. Counties matter because results matter when it comes to services that touch, in our case, almost 750,000 residents. None of it happens without a tireless and dedicated workforce. Here in Monroe County, there are 4,500 people who are responsible for our effective and impactful government. No matter how big or how small their job, I admire them, I respect them, and I'm proud of them. The people who work in Monroe County government embody the spirit of public service, and oftentimes that effort is recognized by the greater community, the state, and even the nation. Collectively, our sheriff's office received its accreditation for the 8th consecutive time, being recognized for demonstrating a commitment to professional excellence. Deputy Bridget Davis was named Deputy of the Year for her actions on January 22, 2014, when she pursued and apprehended an armed suspect who was in a stolen car and had been suspected of shoplifting, hitting a vehicle, and attempting to carjack a minivan. Deputy Robert Costello was named Correction Officer of the Year. On March 7, 2014, Deputy Costello helped save a man at Bristol Mountain Winter Resort. He was off duty, but he performed CPR on the man who was unconscious after suffering a heart attack. The man was transported to Strong by Mercy Flight and made a full recovery. It's not every day that we're presented with a call to action as drastic as helping a fellow human being in need of life-saving support. But it's these moments that can define us. It was a near tragic moment on March 31st of this year that made two men hometown heroes. An employee with the district attorney's office, David Dice, and local resident David Hill proved what it means to be a good Samaritan. After coming across a woman collapsed on Spring Street, both David Dice and David Hill quickly took action. As a result, Valerie Richards was taken to the hospital and treated. I'm pleased to report that Valerie's doing very well in her recovery, but there's no question the heroic actions of these two men saved her life. This year, we welcomed a new interim public health director, Dr. Jeremy Cushman. Dr. Cushman has a reputation as a dedicated professional who puts the lives of others before his own on a daily basis. As physician for emergency medical services, Dr. Cushman was honored by area fire chiefs for his efforts to save the life of a traffic accident victim. I'd like to recognize our Department of Environmental Services Director, Mike Garland, and Department of Transportation Director, Terry Rice, who are both here tonight. Each and every year, we have Monroe County projects singled out and recognized by the American Public Works Association. From the crime lab to the green fueling stations to the Civic Center Green Roof Project to accolades for our green fleet and awards for innovation in road and bridge design. This year, Dan Cavallaro from DES was honored with the prestigious Douglas Zefting Award for Excellence in Public Works. I want to congratulate him on this well-deserved honor. He's been a part of our DES family for 30 years, and the community has benefited from his good work. To all of our employees. As some of you may know, I was the chairperson for the Genesee Transportation Council for 4 years. And during that time, I was able to work with an incredibly skilled group of people from our region. Rich Perrin is the executive director of the GTC and was also honored by the APWA for his outstanding work in transportation planning. We want to congratulate him as well. You know, public works employees are unsung heroes. They work hard. They often work behind the scenes, under the radar. But that work deserves our gratitude because you come across it every day. You may not realize it, but you do. And your life is easier because of what they do. They are truly the foundation for our quality of life. This year is the first time Monroe County identified a young leader to support our annual United Way campaign, and Nicole Dobson from our Human Resources Department was recently recognized by the United Way of Greater Rochester as 2015 Young Leader Club Champion. This club is made up of about 400 of Rochester's most inspiring and active leaders who are dedicated to making a true impact in our community. Together, they invested nearly $500,000 through their donations to help the United Way reach its goal. Pretty amazing. Each year, I'm amazed by the outpouring of generosity demonstrated by Monroe County employees. This year, our workers donated $360,000 to support the United Way to help our residents and our neighbors. I'd like to thank Human Resources Director Brayton Connard, who's overseen Monroe County's United Way campaign each year and has grown it into a tremendous success. Brayton was also presented with the prestigious President's Award from the New York State Civil Service Commission. It is the highest statewide award for a civil service professional. Congratulations to you, Brayton. If you think I'm proud of our employees, I am, so please bear with me for just a few more minutes. Laura Stradley, a U.S. Army veteran and the director of the Monroe County Veterans Service Agency, was recently inducted into the New York State Senate Veterans Hall of Fame. Laura served honorably in the United States Army from 1996 through 2004, retiring at the rank of Staff Sergeant E6. Laura, thank you for your service to our community and to our country. Recently, our Veterans Service Agency received the PFC Dwyer Peer-to-Peer Grant from the New York State Office of Mental Health. This grant will support the work of veterans who personally understand the effects of war, post-traumatic stress disorder, traumatic brain injury, and they can, in a very real way, help their fellow veterans. The VSA will be partnering with Compeer to deliver the services and will also purchase several computers to create an internet cafe in the agency waiting room where veterans will be able to connect with one another in person using a social network that will be on each terminal, and they can also use Skype to reach those who are still serving overseas. Those are a few of the accolades and recognitions from our team this past year. But really, I'm only scratching the surface when it comes to individual impact. For 12 years, I've had a front row seat watching the many men and women who serve this community with dignity and pride. The level of professionalism is astounding, and their contributions immeasurable. I am proud to have been part of their team. Tonight, again, bear with me, I would like to take this opportunity to publicly recognize each of my department heads. A county executive is only as good as his or her team, and this team has accomplished much. So please stand as I read your names. Justin Fiesel, Communications Director. Brayton Connard, our Human Resources Director. Meredith Smith, our County Attorney. Bob Franklin, our Director of Finance. Mike Garland, our DES Director. Laura Stradley, Veterans Service Agency Director. Dr. Jeremy Cushman, our Interim Public Health Director. Jean Larrabee, our leader at Monroe Community Hospital. David Moore, our Public Safety Director. Terry Rice, our Transportation Director. Jennifer Cusey, our Information Technology Director. Larry Staub, our Director of County Parks. Kelly Reed, our Commissioner of Human Services. Bill Taylor, Special Counsel to the Monroe County Executive. Bill Napier, Assistant County Executive. And Judy Seil, our Director of Planning and Economic Development. They all represent the best and brightest in local government, and I thank you. Twelve years ago, I promised to govern collaboratively, govern fairly, govern with integrity, honest, and professionalism. I promised to work hard, to spend your tax dollars wisely, promote a smaller, smarter, more efficient government that lives within its means, fulfilling the promise, protecting the future. Tonight, let me end with one more thank you. On behalf of my husband, Bob, and my family, we would like to thank the residents of Monroe County. You have given me a great gift, the chance to make a difference and to give back. I have never forgotten that I work for you. Sometimes I pinch myself and find it hard to believe that a little girl who was raised in this wonderful town of Irondequoit got the chance to become the county executive and help unleash the unlimited opportunities we have as a community. My ties to Rochester run deep because of my childhood, but also because of a 38-year career that started in a radio newsroom and brought me to a place in the county office building where I follow in the footsteps of those incredible leaders who came before me. Whether sitting at the anchor desk or in the legislative chambers, whether constructing a newscast or creating public policy, this has been an incredibly rewarding experience, largely because of the people that I have met along the way. Every day, my life is touched by people who remind me why our work in government is so important. People who bring into focus the value of public service and the impact of public policy. Preparing for tonight was a time of reflection for me, and tonight is a night of great emotion. Many of you have asked me, what do you want your legacy to be? Well, that's a really hard question, because this job was never about me. If I had to provide an answer, I would say this. My legacy is that I stayed the course from beginning to end because I believed in something greater than myself. I believed in Monroe County, and it's been my great honor and privilege to serve. Ronald Reagan once said, if you're afraid of the future, then get out of the way. Stand aside. The people of this country are ready to move again. I think that's a great way to describe the state of the county. Monroe County residents are ready to move. They feel the wind at their backs. They know we're a community with a rich and proud history behind us and unlimited potential in front of us. It is that spirit that defines us. That spirit will continue to be the cornerstone of our success. Thank you all for coming tonight. God bless you.